Some of the hidden history here involves an earthquake, a shy king, and the assassination of a king. Hello, and welcome to Hidden Histories, Season 1. Season 1, we're looking at the top 10 tourist sites in Lisbon, Portugal. And we're looking at the top 10 tourist sites because we want to have a look at what history is hidden there that you might not see if you come and visit Lisbon. But you're sure to come to these places. It's just that there might be history there that you don't see. And we start in Praca de Comercio because if you come to Lisbon, then you're sure to come to Praca de Comercio. It's a huge square in the center of the city. It's a place where a lot of Lisbon history and a lot of Portuguese history was made here in this huge, beautiful square. When I first visited Lisbon in 1989, and at that time they parked cars in the square here, and I remember walking along the front and looking into Praça de Comercio and thinking, wow, there's a big car park there. That's a very expensive use of land in the center of the city. And I just walked on. Now, today they don't park cars here anymore. Let's push on and have a look at some of the history that is hidden here in Praça do Comercio, Lisbon, Portugal.
In 1511, King Dom Manuel I built a royal palace on this site and transferred the royal court from the Castelo São Jorge to the new palace. The palace was mainly located on the western side of the square, with annexes to the north and east. The square here at that time was called Terroir de Passe, or Palace Yard in English. The life of the court of an absolute monarchy was played out in the grand palace buildings. Visiting diplomats would arrive, and the legal and royal business of Portugal was conducted from here.
So the palace was destroyed in the earthquake of 1755. We're going to have a lot to talk about that earthquake. We're going to have a big series on the earthquake. But suffice to say that when the palace had been destroyed and much of Lisbon had been destroyed by that earthquake, the reconstruction of this area by Marquis de Pombal, he made this big square. And rather than calling it Terroir de Passe, he changed the name to Praça do Comercial, or Commercial Square, or Trade Square. And that tells us a lot about the changing nature of Portugal after the earthquake. It tells us a lot about what Marquis de Pombal wanted to do with Portugal after the earthquake. And we're going to be coming back to the Marquis de Pombal a lot during this series. So going back over 2,000 years since Roman times, the square Praça de Comercio has been a loading dock. It's been a dock, sea dock, where boats have come up the river from all over the world to bring goods from the Portuguese Empire and far off distant lands to be landed in the center of Lisbon here. And in medieval times, there actually used to be a river which flowed up on the left-hand side of the square, on the western edge of the square, and it flowed up through the arch that you sort of see over here, between the arch and the street over there. It used to flow up right into the center of the city. It would flow up to where Rossio Square is today. So there's always been this close connection between the sea, trade, and Praça de Comercio, as it's known today. At the front of Praça de Comercio, we see the city steps, or the Caixa de Colunas. They are. These are the steps that visiting dignitaries would step off their boats from and be welcomed into the city of Lisbon, welcome to Portugal, and they would go up these steps and it would lead them directly into the palace, which tells us that the palace would have been just sort of here on the central left-hand side of the square as we look at it today.
The statue in the center of the square is of King José I, who ruled Portugal from 1750 to 1777, and he gave Marquis de Pombal the role of reconstructing the city after the earthquake in 1755. A competition for a design and sculpture was held, and the winner was Joaquim Machado de Castro. He also made sculptures at the Basilica de Estrela.
Now, I've read that at first King José didn't want to pose for the sculpture. Maybe he was a little shy, and therefore the sculptor came to a compromise with him by placing the accented helmet slightly sort of tilted to draw attention away from his face. Now, the statue has interesting carvings around the base, and I'm not really sure what Machado de Castro's instructions were, but it really gives us an interesting insight into some of the thinking at the time, the sort of psychology maybe of Portugal and the Portuguese state after the 1755 earthquake. Obviously, it's dangerous to interpret, given a modern framework, the historical context within which they were working. I think that we can make some inferences about where Portugal might have been in 1755, in the early 1800s, after that earthquake. On this side of the statue, just here, we have the Greek figure of Triumph, who is leading a horse which is meant to represent Europe, over a human figure, which I read, is meant to represent America. Interesting, we have a depiction of Europe triumphing over America in the late 18th century, early 19th century. On this side of the statue, we have the Greek mythological figure of Fame leading an elephant, which is meant to represent Asia, over a human figure that is meant to represent Africa. Well, that's just really interesting as well. What was going on in the mindset that they thought that it would be good to represent Asia triumphing over Africa? This gives us a great bit of understanding of the hidden history, both of this square and what might have been happening in Portugal in the late 18th century. Now, at the front of the statue here, we have the bas-relief of the Marquis de Pombal, who is a super interesting figure. And above the relief of Pombal, we have the insignia of royal generosity, showing where the city was going to be rebuilt, and most importantly, who was paying for the rebuilding of that city. I'm slightly baffling. And battling the noise of them clearing away the remnants of the end of the marathon yesterday. The square has witnessed many of the most important historical events in Portuguese history, including the assassination of a king, which would eventually lead to the end of the Portuguese monarchy. On the 1st of February 1908, the square was the location for the assassination of King Carlos I, the penultimate king of Portugal. The royal family were traveling in their carriage from the palace of Vila Vicosa back to the royal palace here in Lisbon.
The carriage containing Carlos I and his family passed through the Terrado de Paz. Whilst crossing the square, shots were fired from the crowd by at least two men, Alfredo Luis da Costa and Manuel Buisa. The king died immediately. His heir Louis Philippe was mortally wounded. Manuel was hit in the arm. The assassins were shot on the spot by police and later recognized as members of the Republican Party, which 2 years later overthrew the Portuguese monarchy.
The Rua Augusta Triumphal Arch, this one here, was built to commemorate the earthquake of 1755, which devastated much of Lisbon. It was completed in 1875.
The arch is located at the end of Rua Augusta, one of the city's main pedestrian streets, which leads to Praça de Comercio. The arch's design is inspired by ancient Roman triumphal arches, with ornate carvings and sculptures that depict figures such as glory, valor, and genius. The arch also features allegorical figures representing the Tagus River and the city of Lisbon. Over the years, the Rua Augusta Triumphal Arch has served several purposes. It was used as a customs checkpoint in a prison during the dictatorship of Salazar. It was also used as a lookout during the Second World War. Today, the arch is a popular tourist attraction and an important symbol of Lisbon. Visitors can climb to the top of the arch and enjoy a panoramic view of the city, including the Tagus River and the surrounding hills. The arch is also home to a small museum that explores its history and significance. One of the things that people often notice when they come to Lisbon is the very distinctive pavements made out of these small black and white stones. And this is called calçada, and it's a very traditional Portuguese art form, a way of making pavements. It's incredibly functional because they come loose. You only have to repair a small area of the pavement, and they absorb the water during the infrequent rainstorms here, so there's less water runoff and less flooding of the pavement. I think I'll do a whole video on the distinctive patterns of calçada and their meanings. On we go with the hidden history of Praça de Comercio.
Praça de Comercio is also home to the oldest cafe in Lisbon, which is Marquina de Acada, just behind me. It was established here in 1782 after the reconstruction of the city after the earthquake. It was established by an Italian called Domenico Mignani in 1782, and he supplied ice creams to the royal court. The cafe has had a number of owners and a number of name changes over the years. One of my favorite hidden history notes is that in the early 1800s, it was known as Café dos Jacobinos because it was a hangout for the Jacobins and the libertinos of the day. For a long time, it's been a center of the political and literary life of Lisbon.
Many politicians, intellectuals, and writers have been regular visitors to the Café Martino de Acada over the years, most notably Fernando Pessoa, who is said to have had a coffee here with Almada Negreros 3 days before he died in 1935. Epic Portuguese writer José Saramage was also a frequent visitor to the café. Both Fernando Pessoa and Saramage are said to have a table permanently reserved at the café to this day.
If you do come to Praça Comercio and you want to stay just around the corner, you can stay at the CR7 Hotel. That's Cristiano Ronaldo's own hotel. So if you're a big fan of Cristiano Ronaldo, you can stay at his hotel. I'm told that if you're English and you're really nice and you give them a wink on the way in, they'll give you a discount.
Well, there's a lot more hidden history to uncover in Praça de Comercio. But there's a lot more hidden history to uncover in the rest of Lisbon, and in the rest of the world for that matter. So we'll call it a day for the time being here. If you enjoyed today's video, I would be most grateful if you could give me a like or even a subscribe. And I hope you'll watch the next video when we'll be uncovering the hidden history of the Time Out Market here in Lisbon. Have a great day. Bye.